member, how this work has changed you. So some brief reflections on that, and then we also want to allow a little bit of time to talk about what the next steps are for your organizations or for this group, what ideas people have for bringing the conversation forward so that we can take action on those. Just to acknowledge that we kicked off this meeting with this group of people with Michelle standing in front of you. A whole other topic for conversation and another convening is that of leadership transitions. And as I think all of you or most of you know, we are certainly right in the midst of that at 10,000 Things. And Michelle, this is her last season with 10,000 Things. So if we decide to meet again next year, Michelle will probably not be the catalyst for that meeting. It will be different people. And I am not standing here as the next artistic leader of 10,000 Things, but that this work is really, though inspired in large part by the people who have really moved it forward, it is not person-centric. The ideals of the work really live on in the communities we serve and the work that's created. And for 10,000 Things, that means that it's carried forward through the staff that evolves in the organization, the artists, and the communities. So so that's that. So Michelle is here in the room with us, but she's going to be inhibiting.
Shh.
So
I just want to thank 10,000 Things, Michelle, 10,000 Things, because I know for the convening of this, we don't have a service organization that really serves the specifics of what it is that we do, and sometimes we go to the larger civic or serving organization and we're ignored because we're funky, crazy people, right? And so what I come to these things for, and part of the reason to create the Shakespeare Prison Conference was recharge the batteries, you know, because you're out there battling, and you feel so alone. And the reality is you're not alone, that there's a network of people that are across the country that are doing this work. And to be able to bring people into the room and be able to connect so that when we go home, we know, I need a little pep talk. So to get a hold of somebody to just get recharged via phone is really advantageous. So blessings for this convening, and thank you all for coming.
Yeah, I piggyback on that. I just started a company, and I used to think companies were something that sober adults did, and I realized I just had to do it by myself and do it. But the generosity of people who have done it and my ability to reach out to them and for them to give me great advice, to tell me what worked, to be really supportive, was quite beautiful. So if you're thinking about either your big behemoth organization doing a course change or yourself as an individual, there are a tremendous amount of generous people who will give you their time and their expertise, and it will be life-changing. So reach out. Email me. Email whoever. Call in whoever. I mean, it's really true. Quite beautiful.
Yes, wouldn't it be great if we were not a niche group, but actually the meaning of what it was to perform theater just was, it was endemic in that, to say that it's for everyone. Yeah.
And that's what my big, not so much takeaway, because I think I knew it before, but to be in a room with people who are all talking about the same thing, is that I would hope that all of you guys who work alongside the big company or all of the freelance directors and producers and artists would treat theater the exact same way. We should always be thinking about the audience. We should always be thinking about the story. And that everyone should be in the audience. You know, I mean, I know it's not always the reality that people can afford in terms of the audience, but I mean, like, as creators, this seems normal to me. And I just hope that everyone who works with not only prisons can seep that thought into everywhere else, because I find it absurd that's not the norm.
Does anyone want to share a reflection about a specific instance of the work changing them, or general? That would be fine too, of how this work. The question was actually asked in the previous session. existing theaters who have brought this model in to an existing theater. How did your organization change as a result of that? Or are there things to consider as a result of that? Just a quick time check. We're not going into really in-depth discussions, so these are kind of quick reflections and quick hits on that.
Yeah. I think everyone was just talking like about this. I was brought last year to kick this, the professional concept of this work at Baltimore Center Stage. And a thing that I learned real quickly, being the new kid on the block then, that the institution wasn't fully prepared. I had 3 months to choose a play, cast it, design it, and then get it on the road, and build partnerships and all of that. And Kwame, as you all know, is impassioned about this work, you know. And the idea, I think, was resonating in the institution, but it wasn't until the actual practical work of calendar and all of the design teams and their calendars and all that, that wasn't fully fleshed out. So the thing that I would encourage is, if you're at those larger institutions, or even at the smaller medium ones, make sure that you have that institutional buy-in. That everybody, that it's not just me in my little department, that we're all doing this kind of work. It takes the full institution to be behind this work. And it's the gift that we're giving that expands beyond these four walls that we're in. And I think the more you can lay those seeds, plant those seeds in with the institution, get everybody internally excited about this work and the impact that it has on not only the community, but on the main stages and all of that, I think that will make the job much, well, a little easier, not much easier. And then I think the bigger thing is that in a year, I've heard, being new at the board meetings and the internal meetings, I've heard the conversation shift already. From, you know, beginning a year ago to board members going, okay, so what is this? What? Okay, that sounds interesting. To now this year, okay, so who's gonna fund that one tour, or how can we expand it? Or I have an organization, Daniel, that I think this thing would work fantastically in. So I think the biggest thing is that it's really changed for me as an artist to bring purpose to the work in a way that as an actor I always thought I could do on stage in a role, but to actually have the focus of the work be about bringing purpose and going out to community and having that transformative aspect is starting to slowly but surely impact even the departments of the organization, because all the design teams now are part of the planning. We have a calendar now, so that now they know, okay, this is mobile unit, and now I have their full enthusiasm and excitement and ideas. So I think that that purpose piece has always been important to me, and it's just really gratifying even in this early process.
Honestly, Derek, is a lot of we've heard is that how it can transform the kind of larger, bigger organization, but for a small organization, this work has been transformative in, you know, an incredible amount of ways. Before we started this work, we were basically a non-equity company that did one show a year. And the reason that we got into this work was during a strategic planning process, we identified that what we liked most about our audience for an outdoor summer Shakespeare Festival was that we thought we did a really nice job bringing a really broad cross-section of the community together. And as we were looking at growing, we said, well, how can we, we're probably not doing as good a job as we think we're doing. So how can we really commit to this idea? And the idea came to launch a 10,000 Things Inspired tour. And from that step, it really has transformed every aspect of our organization, starting from the place of Michelle passionately advocating, you know, only do this with the absolute best in your community. So when we started out, because we were funding this program from scratch, every single grant application I wrote was, we do our summer shows with no equity actors. We're gonna do this with at least four equity actors, and then we'll have four non-equity actors. For a small company, it's almost doubled our budget. So just financially, it has transformed us and what we are. It also has transformed the way that artists in our community look at our company. We're a company just outside of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, and we normally kind of struggle to kind of get the really great, exciting actors from Philadelphia who want to come down and do it. And now we have actors going, how can I do this work with you all? And then is how it, you know, how that cycle is going back to the work we started with our summer festival. After our first year of doing the tour, I was like, oh my god, this was so amazing. This is what real diversity in an audience looks like. This is what really getting everyone in a room together looks like. Okay, how can we make that happen with our summer show? So now we're having B, who has been our both of our two tour shows, is going to be directing our summer show this year, so we can try to infuse some of those lessons that we've learned back to our quote-unquote main stage offering. And then for me, I'm starting to look, okay, how can we get those, you know, the groups that we serve the community to, how can we get them to come to our summer festival? So it's incredible to hear how it's transformed the larger organizations, but just for all those kind of smaller ones that's out here as well, to know that it can be equally as transformative, and not just in philosophical ways, but in, you know, that sounds insane to say that an economic driver for a company is going to be something that has zero earned income, you know, possible, so, but it actually has been.
I know how it's changed me.
Great.
I've had a long time. So, this is really selfish. Just from a selfishly artistic standpoint, I am such a better artist than I ever would have been had I not found this kind of work. And it's because this great snowball, because it's because of the audiences. But then you become a better artist, so then you want to perform those audiences more. Then they keep making you better, so you just can't get enough, and it becomes sort of this crazy addiction, but it's feeding you in the best way, because you're not doing it for reviews, you're just doing it for all those right reasons that you said you were doing it when you were 22. And no offense, oh my god, there's so many young, great volunteers in the room. You should do it for that reason, that's why you're doing it. That's what's biting you right now. But then stay in it long enough so that you can get over that. And then become, because I watch our actors, you know, who come through our doors and spend time with us, and I see them go in other stages, and damn it, they're better in those other stages. We're affecting the audiences, but we're also affecting the art. This is an incredible boot camp thing that doesn't often get to happen once you're out of grad school. You know, a lot of our actors, I know when we first were having some, you know, sort of the professionals, they would come in and like, oh my god, this is what I used to love to do. This is how I used to love to work. I thought working would be like this. And then I got out, and then it became a machine. And I was so busy being a machine, I didn't have time to act. Just selfishly, you know, it's made me just a better artist. And before I stop talking, I'll stop talking about it. Because I feel like I've been at my wedding reception, and when I looked at pictures, I was like, oh, they were there? I didn't even talk to them. Because I'm running around, like, doing food and doing, you know, like organizing shit, and so I'm looking at faces I haven't even spoken to. So I put my address on the big whiteboard out there. So tonight from like 6:30 on, come by if you're still in town, you have nothing to do. Bring a bottle of wine if you want to. You know, just hang out and drink coffee, whatever. It'd be really lovely to see some more faces.
Walls with producing organizations where actually there's a lot of limits to what you can and can't do. And actually, I think one of the most significant moments on this process for me was actually just in the dress rehearsal. At the very beginning, David was giving his sort of like opening, like just talking to the audience, practicing sort of like what we were terming jokingly sort of like the prologue, right? And some people came in late. And he turned to them and welcomed them. And like such a simple action of welcoming people who are late instead of shaming them is like such like a significant gesture that defines like what this work is versus like the limitations imposed by like so much of the traditional mainstream theater culture. And I think that actually is also reflected in like all of these little things, like one of the actors mentioned how like sometimes the traditional theater audiences are less willing to participate because there's actually like a fear that you're going to do something to embarrass them. And there were moments in which, you know, I gave a note to the beautiful, generous actress who was playing Jaques that, you know, if there happened to be in all the world a stage, a soldier or a schoolboy to connect with, to see if there was a way to work them into the speech. And because of the generosity of the audience, she was able to get an age-appropriate person, participant, volunteer for every single one of the seven ages of man. And like that generosity, like from her to them, because also a lot of those aren't things that like are actually that flattering to be said about. Like by the third one, I was like, oh, she's still going. It's gonna happen now. And it was only right because that she had been like teaching the little kids how to play her accordion at the beginning, that then that was a safe space for them to. And so just the openness and generosity of the culture of this work, instead of like these like rules of shaming, is just such a significant gift that like I'm so grateful. Like I don't think we'll be able to be undone in my consciousness now.
Yes,
there was. I mean, I've done many things that Michelle has talked about. Life is more important than theater. Like, what we do is important, but we can't, you know, you can't, like, I was just having an argument with my roommate, and she was like, we shouldn't allow late seating. I'm like, if you have a child, and the babysitter doesn't arrive, if you get stuck in traffic, like, what, that comes from an immense place of privilege, the whole no late seating. Like, life happens, and we shouldn't deny them art, even the, as much of the art as they can take at the moment, because they need to live their lives.
Yeah, that's one of the things that really that Tom and I noticed, and Colin, the composer, is that so much traditional way we do theater has an adversarial nature between the actor and the audience, right? They're kind of set up in conflict sometimes, and that disappeared right away. And also at the first place we performed at, we asked if they wanted to serve snacks, and all the snacks they served were pre-wrapped. So just word to the wise, if you ask that, ask for unwrapped. But that became part of the show, right? People got up, and they were hungry, and there were snacks there, and so they got the goddamn snacks and ate them. And it was annoying. It was annoying, and if you were in a traditional theater space, everyone else in the space would have been annoyed at those people. But since this was a community we formed instantaneously, that was it was part of the show. It was part of the time we spent together, and it was really lovely. There's so much there's so much bullshit shame that we put on people who go to shows, and we're like, oh, why don't they listen like this, or why don't they, you know, like the them-ing and us-ing, it just it falls away pretty quick.
Hey, I'm Holly from DC, and for the people who are going to be here tomorrow, I'm going to actually talk about this piece I did, but to your point, I did a piece last July where I thought a lot about like the traditional theatrical experience and what's unappealing about it to me. And then I also thought about how sporting events are so popular and people are so engaged and they're so committed and they actually identify with these, you know, really wealthy athletes on a field that are so far away from them. But there's this like identification, and I wanted to bring more of that into the arts. So I made my dance theater piece, I set it up as a sporting event, and we had snacks, we had a tailgate party, and we had like, I hired some teens to be concessionaires, and they passed out free Cracker Jacks, and we had, you know, cotton candy, and like the atmosphere was so festive, and the idea of the other thing I've been really exploring in my work is audience engagement as a continuum. So it's not just the pre-show and the post-show, and it's also not just the, you know, the community development workshop, but it's actually in layered in and through the performance in various ways. So it can be community members' voices from a workshop becoming part of the soundtrack, or it can be, you know, your audience with pennants and flags on either side of this performance space. It's set up like a racetrack, cheering as you're in the middle of performing, which was an incredible experience for myself and my collaborator. And there was a point where I was really tired, and people were like, you can do it! Yeah, it was like, that traditional elite theater sets up, it's like we broke all of them in one show.
not to get too adversarial toward the model of traditional theater, because there are inherent strengths in that as well, but you speak to this kind of regenerative process that happens between the audiences and the artists, and also just to do a little identification, you mentioned tomorrow, so for those of you who are wondering and haven't heard, TCG is running a session tomorrow for some of the Audience Revolutions cohort, so there will be some people who are staying over tomorrow and participating in that conversation. And if you don't know about the Audience Revolutions program of TCG, which really kind of this conversation starts to get into a little bit, you can certainly find a lot of great information about that program on the TCG website, if you don't already know.
And Gus and I are here, so.
And we're here. And you can speak with them direct from the horse's mouth, except they don't want to say that you're a horse.
Like 7 years ago, I did a few workshops with an English director named Tim Carroll, who was the associate artistic director when Mark Rylance was the director of Shakespeare's Globe. And the workshops he led were wonderful, and one observation that he shared from his experience with us was that his very favorite performances were always ones where accidents happened, where like a bird landed on the stage and the actor had to take it in, or not take it in, and the audience sort of lean further in or got alienated by the response to it. And so he and some colleagues, and he's a big soccer fan, and so they developed their own model of making theater where casting was like determined on the night of the performance by audience members like playing rock, paper, scissors on behalf of the actor. So he had one way of like embracing and pushing into the unpredictability. And I feel like, for me, one of the most thrilling things about witnessing 10,000 Things, Delaware Shakespeare, doing our work at the company, has been that the very nature of the tours creates that unpredictability for you and really rewards actors who know how to be permeable and know how to really listen at the same time as they're speaking. And so it's been really fun to see theater performances that come closer to the thrill of, I don't mean to say sports are better than theater, but I think what's exciting about them is you don't know what's going to happen, and a mistake could be made, like missing a goal is as exciting as making a goal in some ways. Yeah, so that's been a real thrill, is just how radically it embraces.
I'm going to take an opportunity to just acknowledge that a lot of what I hear in some of the themes of what people are saying is just the theme of generosity, and some of that is generosity in the organization, and some is in the creation process, and some is in actually the technique of acting with a generous presence. And I'm going to thread that theme of generosity into kind of the next half of this discussion, which is how can we as a group, and those who might join this group or who should be in this group but are not right now, how can we serve each other going forward beyond just this conversation? I think everyone has experienced this over this weekend, that conversations are very free-flowing, and that people that you've maybe never met before have things that they can offer you and are quite willing to offer. Here's what I did that worked, and here's what I did that didn't work, and maybe it'll work for you, but it was problematic in this way for us. So I think that there is a lot of willingness in this room, and are there things that we can identify that we would like to take action on, or that might be good to consider moving forward, whether that goes to the place of another convening, or a technological way to stay in touch, or so on. Yeah.
Yeah, I would just love to, I mean, one thing that was crucial for us was just getting some templates. Started the work. this kind of work, you know, in kind of Google Drive for like surveys, or you know, like the public gave us their inventory list for set and costume pieces, you know. So when we were starting out as a small, you know, small company, to not have to reinvent those things from scratch made it so hugely helpful for us to go like, this worked, and you know, and it gave us gold shiny stars in the eyes of the prisons, you know, because of all the things that were shared with us that were already proven to work. So some kind of, you know, place where we can throw up those things that other people can take and adapt and use if they would want to.
Does anybody have, in terms of the idea of some kind of technological share, Google Drive or Dropbox kind of thing, does anyone have a red flag on that? Is there any reason that that wouldn't be a good idea? So.
Share documents templates, like you talked about, just opening it up. Like, so I shared a document at my session of kind of how I approach a partnership, and just from that session, I'm going to go back and edit and include and keep going, and that's the greatness of this discussion here. So putting those templates up there, and then also giving the space for like commenting on some of those templates. If you see something, or like you try them out and be like, that was great, but maybe this is a different kind of, like this worked for us, so that within the documents perhaps there's a place for discussion. We'll see how successful that is, maybe it's not, but.
Yeah, the tendency, I don't know if this is exactly what you're saying, but I'm gonna see and expand. The tendency when you put something in writing and share it, for it to be a static thing,
yeah,
or a kind of answer, and it loses its conversational quality. So maybe attending to this is like agreeing to a spirit of this is not an answer or set in stone. This is kind of where we're at in the moment with language around something, and that commentary would not be taken personally or not be offered in a judgmental way, but that, you know, there's room for us to learn from each other and things would be changed. And,
yeah. And specifically, I'm thinking around language. Like, I feel like a lot of you are articulating the way I've been feeling for years with better words, and I've really appreciated that over the last couple days too, to like figure out how to be more inclusive and responsive and heartfelt in what I've been kind of feeling here.
I think that thing about a list of some kind of sharing, a list of the shows that work, right? That we find that really work, and some that, and not to say that this one doesn't work, you could say we tried it, we couldn't make it work, but here's why we think. It's not about the show, it's not a literary criticism list. It's a, because we know what this is like, you know, here's what the limitations are, here's what the opportunities are. And then sort of second part of that is there's been a lot of talk about new works and trying to find even creative ways to bring new work to this. You know, opera companies do it all the time, it's so damn expensive, they co-commission pieces because it's so easy, they all have the same damn size stages. So you build that set, we all pay for the set, and then it moves here, and then we perform it, and then it moves around. So we know what this space is like. It's all kind of similar. You know, what about, you know, co-commissioning playwrights who can say, oh my god, I'll have four companies do my show.
I will say one thing, like Kira wanted me to offer to all of you. She's happy to eat. She's written five plays for 10,000 things. They all work great. And she said she'd offer to email to any of you who wanted try something new and fun with your audiences. That is
because this is a really
specific
way.
Some people are
way
happy to share, for sure. Yeah, they work really well.
So that would be, you know, teaming up, you know, so that they know that it's, because it is a different thing. This is a different kind of writing.
Just let's just take a 1 minute to praise Kira a little bit. She is on a Mellon grant as a playwright in residence for 10,000 things. And this is her fifth year. Next year will be the last year of that. So I don't want anyone to think that she's only a 10,000 things playwright. And that will be our right on the heels of our leadership transition with Michelle. Kira will be moving on from 10,000 things and hopefully into your theaters.
I'm wondering, just to take it one step farther, has there ever been co-producing where you tour each other's network? It might be a way to extend actor engagements and also just learn from each other in our home ground.
traveling around the country in 2015 when a lot of presidential candidates were traveling around the country, like, and sort of like telling their American story to, you know, to audiences that they were seeing everywhere they were going. And she was kind of, you know, keeping an eye on that everywhere she was going. And she felt like, okay, it next needs to be artists who are doing this and doing it in like communities who are wrestling with things the way the venue hosts and the partners like are, you know, kind of like in the thick of like the real stuff of America. And, you know, getting somebody from, I don't know, Florida, California, like, you know, being a touring company together, you know, and guessing each other's communities. I don't know, that really inspires me.
I mean, the struggle with that is always funding.
Oh, yeah.
We have lots of funding here, but I mean, the sales tax funding is great, but someone in the legislature went, nope, can't leave the state. So, like, we can't partner outside of the state.
With that funding, but there's other funding sources.
Yeah.
Yeah, and if anyone's interested, I've got a great show for One Actor and One Musician. I would love to do again. Just give me a call.
Yeah, so co-producing, sharing productions. Yeah.
For anyone who works in like ensemble-based models, the Network Ensemble Theaters right now is working on a digital tool that's not out yet, but it will be, so keep your eyes out for specifically that. So this idea of kind of like, if your network and this network, I have this resource, for example, I work in an ensemble-based theater that has a space, right? But what we don't have is we can't seem to find lighting designers lately. Maybe your theater company and ensemble actually has a light designer in residence that works frequently in your ensemble, but you might need that space that they have. And so they're trying to come up with a way to do that. So if you guys aren't with that organization, maybe check it out and follow that development as they're building that.
What is that
called again?
I don't know if I'm saying that correctly. You know more about
this. You did it so well. Yeah. If you want to, you can ask me. I'm on the board of that.
Yeah.
But it's called Connector, and that's the very goal, is to create alternative models of these for sharing the word.
Yeah. Yeah.
Feel free to just check in with me.
Gus.
You know, I'd say on a, not quite on the fully co-producing or sharing production models, but the Shakespeare Theater Association has had some success with this of getting members from each other's theaters to go to other places and do work. Mm-hmm. So like if you know, one of the actors who has done a couple of our touring shows, you know, maybe there's a way for them to join the 10,000 Things cast or us show so that we could learn from each other without that folly of like, oh crap, we're gonna take our entire, we have to find a grant to take our entire production to Minneapolis, you know, and then, but to be able to have artists on a kind of one company to one company basis learn and then bring that back.
I travel. I love travel.
So an actor, Sasha, I changed that to artist network because that would also apply to directors and designers who work in this model really well that might transfer really well.
Musicians.
Yes.
All my kids are adults now as of 2 days ago.
Sonia. Don't know me, and I'm speaking more as someone who's really interested in the model, living in the Twin Cities, and as a longtime audience member and a teacher of social change theater. And I've been really interested to listen for partnership models that are, I know that, I know Michelle speaks about, and other people have spoken about, the play being the thing, and this is not social work, and this is not about undoing systems that create incarcerated bodies. But at the same time, I felt like the work is really softening. The work can enable people to think differently, to undo a lot of destructive stereotypes. And so I'm just curious about, I've heard other people talk about modes of partnership with institutions that aren't just about hosting, but about a kind of reciprocity around, this is what we do as artists. We create this space of softening and how it works with your agenda as an institution, whether it's as a transitional space or a more restorative justice model, and how are those partnerships enabled? Where does the work go? And especially even some of the small, the best practices around how you enter into a space and help an audience to orient themselves to the play, the creation of the artwork that's themed. in the art therapy. All those best practices seem like it would be useful to have a space to share.
So it would that, do you think that, that an online platform would be a likely place for discussion about that, or does that discussion want to take place in another format? Because in the that seems like there could be a pretty rich conversation that goes beyond the next 20 minutes.
Yeah.
How would we further that conversation? Yeah.
The National New Play Network does a thing that is like sometimes more successful than others, but they'll have chats, and they're usually, I think, monthly or bi-monthly, where it's like, it's the managing director of NPN chat, and everybody, you know, while they're multitasking and doing other things, is sort of on a live chat with each other for an hour, and they'll talk about some relevant thing that we're all dealing with. Like, having occasional room for discussions like this, where it's an hour or so, like, open forum to just be like, let's just talk about partnerships today. What are some good partnerships that people have going right now? What are some challenges that could be something that could work? It works to varying degrees, as I said.
So you're saying the NPN chats as a model, not as something necessarily that
no,
people
yeah,
talk about, but as a model that might be something we could adopt.
Yeah.
I didn't mean to cut off. People do have, if people do want to respond to that question about partnering with community organizations.
Well, it wasn't necessarily a conversation to have now, but an idea of,
yeah.
This, is there a forum or space?
I think we touched our tone into that conversation yesterday at the Touring Cup breakout.
Yeah. Yeah, for instance, I'm really interested to know, too, about organizations who might be partnering with community organizations for office space or sharing, having a desk in a, I know Del Shakes has their partnership with Opera Delaware, that's a conversation that again is beyond the scope of our time, but just hearing about people who are doing some back office sharing or partnering with community organizations in that way, but that's a very specific way of partnering, so other aspects as well.
Informal thought, but it'd be interesting continuing conversation about not just talking internally, but taking what is happening in these places and making sure it's known about externally in the general public. And I know Michelle wrote a book and the New York Times did a story, and I think there's a continuation of what's happened since then with what's happening here and this work happening in places that is valuable to get out into public consciousness. I have no idea what that looks like or how we capture some of the stories that are happening in these places. But I think there's something we should think about intentionally about capturing that in some way.
Can I respond to that?
Yes.
After the first two Shakespeare and Prisons conferences, we created a closed Facebook group, as simple as that, and just added interested members. And that's just become a repository for information. There's data that I sent out to you guys yesterday that I think I got from you, Kate, that you posted it there months ago, but I knew it was there. And when there are stories about programs, whether it's Actors Gang or the Old Globe or Del Shakes Tour or whatever, like those are all highlighted. And then they become topics forums as well. Like, hey, I'm having a problem with this funder because they want X, Y, and Z in these metrics. I don't know how to do this. Mm-hmm. And people just pipe in. So it's very, simplify, 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 right?
Yeah. Great. Other thoughts about, somebody asked me today about mentorship. Michelle has been a mentor for other organizations looking to start this model. And also to directors who are looking to direct in this model. As Michelle moves in on to the next phase of her activities and her life, I imagine I'm thinking about how that kind of mentorship in 10,000 Things will shift and what our staff can offer in the way of mentorship as well. So I don't have an answer to that yet, but certainly somebody asked me about mentorship and I imagine what people can say how much capacity they have in their organizations to offer mentorship to up-and-coming practitioners as well. Is that of interest to people on one side of the coin or the other?
Yes.
So looking at how to further our kind of mentorship model. Or how to make those opportunities known and shared amongst us might be good. Are there other things that would be helpful for you as practitioners that this group could be of service?
I would personally love to know people's successes. You know, so a platform, perhaps a Facebook platform, who knows? But like, when you have a great show, share it with us. Let us know how that impacted your artists, how it impacted the community. Like, let's lift each other up as much as possible too in our successes.
We got just as an example of that. Michelle, maybe one of you can probably speak more articulately to this, but when we got it's not a quote, it's a whole letter from the inmate in San Francisco, Cal Shakes, right?
Yeah.
Rebecca talked a little bit about this experience of, it was not just one person, but it was a friendship amongst two women in one of the prisons, and we got a letter after. Do you want to speak to it, Eric?
No, I was just going to say that, so Rebecca's story the other day, which I think everyone was in the room for, or half of you were in the room for, probably did. She spoke about one of the women at FCI Dublin, where we were performing The Tempest, who was very moved by Miranda, and sort of, in a way, was Miranda became a proxy for her own daughter, and she did not see get married. We received a letter the next year, a handwritten letter, with no return address. That's not true, it said FCI Dublin on the envelope, but it was from this woman's friend who was sitting next to her watching the show, and she wrote to inform us that her friend, who had this experience, had been pardoned by Obama. It was one of the last pardons that he issued. And so she was not living in Florida, and that this other person who was writing us was about to be released then 3 months later. So
yeah, and it spoke to the impact of the work not only on the person that she was writing about, but how that impacted kind of their friendship and their process together in prison, and to the extent that a year later she was writing about her friend's experience of this. And this was so moving, and spoke so movingly about the work that we ended up printing off that response and sharing it with our patrons, and even talking about it with our funders and saying, this is not our work, but this is the same model of this work, and we get responses like this as well. Almost every performance we perform for, we get those kind of, that this is a particularly eloquent example of that response that's worth sharing, even if it's not from our organization. Yeah.
Along with sharing successes, the best way I learn is failing forward, right? And so with the successes, I want to know what failures did you make along the way and how did you learn from them? How are we failing forward, learning from our mistakes? Because I failed an awful lot putting this show
together. The teacher in me rebels against the failing, so I'm just going to amend and add on to that challenges. But yeah. I mean, it's great, you know, we all...
Yeah, I've tried to reclaim the idea that failure is a part of the process,
yeah.
And I have to fail forward.
Great. Someone have a hand over here? Okay, I think we're settling on a kind of really nice space of silence, and I think a lot of people feel saturated with... so again, our gratitude again to everyone who is taking this work and moving with this work out into communities and who
all the notes that our awesome note takers have been taking.
Babies are welcome tonight.